Today, I want to share with you one proven tip regarding double exposures so that you can achieve great results when creating them in Photoshop. Stick around. Okay, so these two are the images that I'm going to use for this double exposure. If you want to download them, the links are in the description. And if you want to recreate this double exposure after watching this tutorial, make sure you tag me with your results on Instagram. The first thing that I want to do is to create a new document. So I'm going to go to File, New. I have a template called YouTube that I created. It's a 1920 by 1080 pixels and color profile sRGB. I'm going to click on Create and I have a white background, which is awesome. Now I'm going to take this image and drag it into the new document. As you can see, the image is too big right now, so I'm holding down Shift and scale this image proportionally until I'm satisfied. Okay, something like that is good. I'm just gonna press enter. And the next step is to get rid of some details here in this image. Like for example, this object right here in the hair. I'm not sure what this is. If you know what it is, please tell me in the comments because I searched online, but I couldn't find anything related to this. I'm grabbing the lasso tool from here and I make a selection around this object, leaving some room for Photoshop's artificial intelligence to be able to get rid of it. The next thing is to go to Edit, Content Aware Fill, and you can see that Photoshop is doing a great job by removing this object. All I want to do is to make sure that I select current layer here for the output and then click OK. To deselect, I just press Ctrl D and then Ctrl plus 0 to fit the image on the screen. Now I want to get rid of the background. So with this layer selected, I choose this tool right here called Quick Selection Tool and then press on Select Subject. Again, the artificial intelligence will do a great job at this. As you can see, it's selected the whole subject and all I need to do is to press on Add Layer Mask. And you can see that the background was hidden. It was not deleted because it's on this layer mask. So if I press Shift and click on the layer mask, you can see that the background is revealed. The next thing I want to do is to darken some parts from this portrait. Like for example, this part right here and also a part from her ear. How am I going to do this? Very simple. I'm just going to add a curves adjustment layer from here. And then take this point and bring it to the right. Now you can see that I still have some highlights here that I want to hide. And to do this, I grab this point and bring it down just like this. Now the curves adjustment layer is affecting the whole image, but I want to affect only the layer below this. So I'm going to clip it to the layer below by holding down Alt and then pressing on this line between the two layers. So now this curves adjustment layer is affecting only this layer. The next step is to bring in the second image. So I'm gonna drag the image into the new document. This image is also quite big, so I'm gonna resize it. And now I have a problem. I don't know how much do I need to resize this image. I want to see what's below this image. And there are two options. Either I use the opacity for this layer and bring it down so that I can see what's behind, or a better method, which I like, is to duplicate this layer mask onto this layer. Let me show you how. You just press Alt or Command and click and drag this layer mask onto the second image. And now you can see that this layer mask is affecting this layer as well. But if I select this image and I try to move it, you can see that it moves together with the layer mask, with this layer mask. So I'm gonna press Ctrl Z because I don't like this. I want to move the image independently from the layer mask. So you can see this chain right here, just click it once, and now these two are separated. So if I move the image, you can see that the layer mask stays in place. Now I'm just gonna resize it even more, make it smaller. You can also use the arrows to move the image, but if you want to move it faster, just press Shift and the arrow keys, just like this. What I want to do now is to select parts of this image and scale them somehow to fill in this silhouette. Okay, so I'm going to use the rectangular marquee tool and then select this area from here. Make sure this layer is selected for the second image and then go to Edit, Content Aware Scale. And I'm just going to drag this until right here and then press Enter. Let's do it for the left side as well. content aware scale, drag it outside, and then take this part of the image. Okay, it looks nice. And then this part, same procedure, content aware scale, and drag this here. Okay, I like it. What I notice on the second image is that the black areas are not completely black. So there are some faded blacks, some crushed blacks. I'm going to solve this by adding a new curves adjustment layer and then grabbing this point, this handle right here, holding down Alt in the same time, and I'm going to start dragging it to the right until I can see some pixels that are colored. This means that those areas are almost completely black. But for me, this is okay. And you can see a before and after if I hide and unhide this curves adjustment layer. Now we have some real blacks right here. But one thing that I need to do is to clip this curves adjustment layer to this image. So I'm holding down Alt or Command and click here. Okay, awesome. And now let me tell you about that tip, that proven tip for better double exposures. You can see that these two images have something in common. And that thing is the lighting. So if you want to take better photos that you can later combine into a great double exposure for this type of double exposure, just make sure you take those photos against the lighting. You can see in the first one that the background is very bright and the subject is almost completely black. And this is very important because this image will be your main image. And for the second image, it's very important that also you will shoot against the light. So in this case, we have a beautiful sunset behind the model. But in the same time, for the second image, make sure you have some bright areas in the scene. So these two images, when they are combined together, they make a great double exposure. So the conclusion is that if you want to create easy double exposures, just like in this video, you can take photos by respecting this simple rule. Just put your subject in the front of the lens, but make sure the bright parts are behind the subject. And this is very easy to do if you shoot against the light. Now let's get back to the video because I want to add a nice background to this double exposure and also add a special effect to it, you will see. So I needed a vintage scratched background. And I found this pack that has a few different backgrounds, but I love this one because it has a warm tone in it. It's from Envato Elements. They basically have almost anything you need as a creator. There's an affiliate link down in the description, and if you want a discount to sign up to Envato Elements, use that link. I also found this flares pack, and I will use one of these to add some sun rays to the image. So from this whole pack, I like this a lot, and I'm going to import it into Photoshop. So this is the background. You can see that it has some warm tones and also some scratches. This is what I was looking for because I want to create a moody vintage look for this double exposure. So the first thing that I want to do is to grab this image and import it into this double exposure document. Make sure you put it above all the layers. Maybe I need to resize it just a bit, something like this. And I also want to put this onto hard light blending mode. But as you can see in the second image, the sun is coming from this side. So I will flip this image horizontally. It looks nice, but it's too intense. So what I will do next is to lower the opacity to, let's say, something around 80%. And the next thing that I want to do is to set this layer to not affect the dark parts of this image right here. And I'm gonna solve this by using the blend if options. So I'm gonna double click on this layer right here, and you can see this blend if panel. And for the underlying layer, I will choose this handle. If I'm bringing it to the right, it will not affect the dark parts from the layer below. But this is a bit harsh, so actually you can hold down Alt and separate these two handles so that the transition is much smoother. Okay, that looks fine to me, and I will press OK. So you can see a before and after now. Of course, the background for the second image was modified as well, was affected just a little bit, but it blends in well. Now it's time to unveil some parts of the woman's face. So I'm gonna use this layer mask, and with a brush, I'm just gonna paint with black on the face to unveil some parts. You can just dab and use different amounts of flow to make your edit. Something like that is fine. Okay, I like it. Awesome. But I see one more problem here. You know what it is? It's about the hair. So if I take a look here, you can see that the hair looks very good, the selection. But here, not so good. That's because when I applied the layer mask, the hair wasn't selected perfectly. But I can solve it. I select this curves layer, and then I add a new layer above this one. I also want to clip it to the curves layer, so I hold down Alt or Command and click here. So this layer is now clipped to this one. Now it's time to use the clone stamp tool. Make sure you choose all layers from here, from this dropdown, and then I sample from here and I fill in these areas just like this. So now it looks much better. Control 0 to fit the image on the screen, a very important shortcut actually in Photoshop. So you can see a before and after. This is a big difference. It's a small detail, but it makes a big difference. Okay, the next thing is to bring in the flare. From all these flares, this one is my favorite. So I'm gonna grab it and bring it into Photoshop. Now I just drag it into my document and make sure I place it above all these layers. And of course, I need to resize it because it's bigger than I need it to be. I also will rotate it, maybe zoom in just a bit to see what I'm doing. Let's reposition it because the sun is shining from right over there. Let's make it even smaller. Just like that. Awesome. You can also experiment and choose different blending modes. Let's see how it looks with screen, for example. Actually, screen looks much better than normal. What's your opinion about this? I really like it. I think it gives a much more appealing look to this double exposure. The next thing I want to do is to add a hue saturation layer. And again, this will make a very small difference, but it will be a difference. So I'm just going to use the hue slider and make this sunset even more appealing by dragging this slider onto the left side. So let's say -5, -3. Yeah. Okay, so I want you to be honest and leave me a comment if you like this edit or not, or what could be done more to make this image better than this, because I want to learn from you guys. But I'm not sure if you know this, but this is my third double exposure Photoshop tutorial on this channel. So if you want to see the other two, they are on the screen right now. Thank you so much for watching until the end, and catch you in the next one.